Hi everyone, my name is Fyodor Mitev, and in this lecture I want to discuss the notion of the attention economy and the phenomenon of the long tail effect, also known as Pareto distribution or a power law distribution. And as usual, I'll proceed in a structured way, so I'll start with a brief discussion of content dynamics that can be observed in what we described earlier in another lecture as this new economy. Then I'll talk a little bit about an interesting effect of mass participation at scale. And then we'll move to a discussion of long tails and power law distributions. And finally, we will try and systematize all of this into a perspective on the attention economy. All right, so let's start talking about content dynamics first. And as a reminder, our starting point is with the emergence of global information networks, first with the telegraph in the middle of the 19th century, and following that with broadcast media, and then finally with the internet. We have this phenomena which emerge with the arrival of global information networks. So we have the phenomenon of information decoupling from matter. We have a compression of space-time, which manifests itself in a variety of different ways, and we've already discussed that. We have, first and foremost, the arrival of global information networks, allowing global participation in the flow of information, and fundamentally real-time coordination and control at scale. We have the emergence of this strange and weird and beautiful notion of cyberspace, which Esther Dyson and her colleagues describe as more ecosystem than machine, a bioelectronic environment that is literally universal. It's we will be returning to this notion again and again, the notion of the bioelectronic environment, the mixture of the physical and the virtual. Simultaneously, we've already established that there is a completely new paradigm arising from these developments. And this paradigm has been described as a network society paradigm. And the network society is a social structure made of networks powered by microelectronics-based information and communication technologies, as described by Manuel Castell. So a network society is first and foremost made from a completely new type of social structures and a completely new type of modes of organization and participation. And this society is characterized with a completely new type of valorization, right? So what becomes valuable here in this network society paradigm is knowledge. And again, this is described as by Esther Dyson and colleagues as a third wave economy, where the central resource is actionable knowledge, unlike the second wave economy, where you have an industrial form of organization where the main resource is labor. Right, the labor on the assembly line in the factory with machines and large industries. Whereas here we have a completely new type of labor participating, a new type of resource emerging, actionable knowledge. And the key characteristics of this network society paradigm we've already isolated are the fact that the social structure of society is made of information networks. It's a bioelectronic environment, literally pervasive environment, which invades the body itself. Its central resource is actionable knowledge. Its logic of participation is one of inclusion and exclusion. If you are not on the network, you are invisible, you do not exist. And its strategic space, because of the fact that it operates based on knowledge valorization, is people's minds, the minds of the users, the minds of the nodes of the network. This society, this bioelectronic environment is global. It favors intangible things, it favors ideas, information, relationships, and it's very intensely and densely interconnected. We also established that the flow of information across these global information networks requires low network transaction costs. These are a reminder, network transaction costs are the cost that each network, no matter its topology, has to pay in order to perform itself into existence, right? So these are the costs that the network has to pay in terms of coordination and control, right? And these are non-negotiable costs, and they are a function of the topology of the network. So the way the network is organized, whether as a hierarchical centralized network with optimized and very efficient flows, or as a distributed flat network with a very inefficient flows of information, the way the network is organized topologically and architecturally, if you will, determines the network transaction costs and the flow of information. And we also established that low network transaction costs, right, which are optimal for fast information flows, require decentralization. They require the network to be decentralized or distributed, but at least decentralized. So all of this leads to a mapping of this new economy emerging with the network society paradigm. And this is an economy organized around knowledge work. It's characterized by global information flows. Operations are decentralized, even in the case of global corporations operating in hundreds of countries. This is always the case. They try and decentralize as much as possible. And the primary value proposition in this new economy is in connecting nodes to the network, so adding new participants to the network itself and to different services and platforms on the network, and in the process itself of sorting information. And this brings us to another phenomenon which emerges here, the phenomenon of liquid labor. So in an environment where you have free information flows, the logic of these flows demands not only a low network transaction cost, but it demands labor, so people who are participating in the routing of the and processing of the flow of information. So it demands labor that is unrestrained by any border, so labor that is ready to participate at all times and is always available for work. And the result is the generation as a side effect almost of a type of life in this new economy, which we described as liquid life after Zygmunt Bauman. So this is a life characterized by the almost complete obliteration of the boundaries and borders of the individual. So remember this notion of the bioelectronic space, right? So it's an obliteration of individual borders, but also family, state and geographical borders, right? The information must flow. This automatically leads to a total homogenization of time and space, the creation of this notion of personal information spaces, where every node, right, every human participating in the network, and more and more every non-human, as we will discover down the track in another lecture, is characterized by existing in what we described as a personal information space, characterized by participating in the network while being physically in a location, but mentally, as it were, absent from that location, right? In a bubble, as it were, in that personal information space. This leads to presence bleed, right? So this notion of being present but absent simultaneously, because one is involved in another space, in cyberspace. And this is also characterized by the chronic task of information processing. So you have to be constantly available for the sorting of information, right? Because information flows demand constant engagement. And this leads to, when we extrapolate this to a macro level, to a macro perspective of the effects of this new economy on work and on labor, this leads to a very precarious existence, to an existence where one is in a constant flux and in a state of presence absence, as it were, with less and less certainty. And our starting point for this lecture is what emerges from everything we've discovered so far. This notion of an information-based society, right, the network society paradigm, automatically presumes that such a society is a society of content abundance. Why is that? Because of what we discussed so far, right? So you have continuous boundary crossing, border crossing information flows, and we have simultaneously the incessant task of sorting, right? So information is continuously engaged with, continuously multiplied by all of these new nodes engaging with the network. So this is a society of content abundance, and this has profound implications. And to understand these implications, it's important to contrast the society with what was before, right? Before the arrival of the internet. And before the arrival of the internet, our society, right, the industrial society, was characterized by what we can describe as a legacy media economic model. This is the economic model of broadcast media, where the cost of production, the cost of participation in the act of broadcasting, right, itself acted as a filter. So I've tried to illustrate this here through this graph, where we have the process of creation of media broken down into ideation and production and distribution, and the point of sale itself, point of sale to an audience, the entire process involving both high production costs, right? So each and every aspect of the process involves the need to engage the act of production, which in and of itself is expensive because of the nature of broadcast media. And in turn, this generates high risks of failure because the high production costs demanded upfront, right? So think in terms of publishing a book with a publisher, right? And the cost that the publisher has to ideate, produce, distribute, and sell. Think in terms of a TV show, think in terms of a radio network, right? So or film, no matter what broadcast media you think of, this model applies, right? Hence the legacy media paradigm. There is high production cost and high risk of failure. And this generates an environment where there is a closed off process of ideation, production, distribution, and sales, which interfaces with the audience at large only at the point of sale itself, right? So the audience can engage with this process only at the end point, where it is rendered as passive consumers, purchasers, if you will, of that information packaged as product. And so this is an environment of high cost of production and high risk of failure, which act as filters for participation, quality, and distribution. So they automatically lower tremendously the amount of content that is being generated, right? So think in terms of the number of films generated by Hollywood each year. So you're looking at several hundred at best, right? Even such high production numbers environments such as Bollywood in India can generate around 800 or so films per year, right? And now contrast this with YouTube, for example, how many new pieces of content appear there each day. So we're returning back to the legacy media paradigm. We have highly centralized production processes, hence highly centralized networks, highly centralized broadcast communication, and ideation, production, distribution, and sales. And this should be contrasted with what we're observing now in this new economy, right? The emergent media economic model, for lack of a better description. And this economic model is one of content abundance, as we already established, And it's characterized by a low to non-existent cost of production and the absence of filters, right? So the users themselves can participate in each and every aspect of the process. Users can participate only in terms of ideation or production or distribution or sales or throughout the entire process. And because of this low to non-existent cost of entry, the entire process is a very low cost or zero cost, which in turn automatically lowers the risk of failure, because if one fails, there is no cost to that failure, right? So this lowers automatically the entire threshold for entry and participation when it comes to the generation of content, which in turn leads to an avalanche of content emerging and continuing, right? So it's a many-to-many process, so because many people can participate and can share and broadcast content to many other people, right? So each node in the network can broadcast to the entire network, theoretically. There is low risk of failure associated with that, and there is no filter for participation and quality as a result. And this is, needless to say, a decentralized network, form of network communication characterized by mass participation and interaction. So again, we have an information-based society being a society of content abundance. And having established that, it's now important to consider what does this mean in terms of participation, because we've already established what the content dynamics here are. They are invariably pointing towards an increase in content, right? Towards further content abundance. So what about the process of participation itself, right? By the people who generate that content. And Clay Shirky, who's a media theorist from New York University, has a really interesting perspective on that when he points out to the emergence of this phenomenon of mass amateurization. And this notion of mass amateurization is really interesting because as he describes it, the ability, the low threshold for entry and participation leads to a phenomenon where everyone can participate, and the emergence of platforms making that participation cost efficient and possible. And as a result, in the context of blogging here, but this also is valid for all sorts of other content production activities, mass maturation is an emergent effect, right? Because everyone can participate. The role of the opinion leader as such, the role of the professional or expert as such in the context of content generation and in the context of aesthetics and taste, if you will, in terms of content, disappears completely, right? So think in terms of how the role of the opinion leader when it comes to the value of specific piece of content used to be in a legacy media paradigm where you had very limited avenues for engaging with content, right? So opinion leaders were extremely important back then, right? So people who would tell you, who would write, for example, movie reviews or book reviews, etc. So there would be a few trusted authority figures or experts who would provide expert opinion on a very limited selection of content. Now imagine how this plays out in the environment when we are in now, in the environment which is described here by Clay Shirky, where this is completely beside the point, because you have such avalanches of content and so many different perspectives to pick from that the end result is mass amateurization in terms of the production, in terms of selection, and in terms of taste itself, right? In his words, weblogs fix the inefficiencies traditional publishers are paid to overcome one book at a time. And in a world where publishing is that efficient, it is no longer an activity worth paying for. So there is a very interesting dynamic here appearing through the process of user participation. So user participation and the generation of content naturally leads to content abundance. But content abundance in turn leads to a downward pressure on storage costs, literally, right? On the cost to store that content for others to make use of or share. Right? So there's a continuous downward pressure on storage costs, which in turn, like the lowering of storage costs, makes possible even further content abundance and even further user participation. So think here in terms of the cost of storing YouTube videos, right? Or the cost of storing podcasts or any other content you can think of, right? There is a reason why YouTube, it's free to post your video on YouTube. And this is exactly this dynamic in play, right? User participation leading to content abundance, leading to low storage costs, which in turn further is a closed loop, further increase content abundance. And this is captured very well by Stuart Brown when he talks about information wanting to be free, right? So this is, you see here this dynamic in play. And as Tim O'Reilly points out, the person who coined the term Web 2.0 in the early 2000s, users add value, but only a small percentage of users will go to the trouble of adding value to application via explicit means. Therefore, Web 2.0 companies set inclusive defaults for aggregating user data and building value as a side effect of ordinary use of the application. They build systems that get better the more people use them. So think here again of systems such as YouTube or applications such as Gmail, right? So the more people use them, the more value the makers of these applications, in this case Google, can extract from the users while users are going through their activities using the application, right? So the value here is extracted as a side effect of the ordinary use of the application. Right? And concomitantly, the system increases in its utility, it gets better, in other words, the more users are added, right? So it scales up very easily, very well. This is completely counterintuitive from the perspective of the legacy media model, where the more people are added to a network, to a system, the harder it is to maintain low transaction costs when it comes to that network. And again, Tim O'Reilly here describing this, the web of connections grows organically as an output of the collective activity of all web users. It's an emergent quality here, right? Much as synapses form in the brain. So we have user participation leading to content abundance, which in turn puts downward pressure on storage costs, which in turn makes even further content abundance possible. And interestingly here, what happens is that there is a what Tim O'Reilly describes as an architecture of participation emerging, right? So this is interesting phenomenon because the service itself stops acting as a provider of content as such, right? This is not where its primary value is from the perspective of the service and from the perspective of the users as well. The primary value here is what Tim O'Reilly describes as being an intelligent broker, connecting the edges to each other and harnessing the power of the users themselves. So the primary value here is to act as a facilitator for the finding of information, but that's not any information, but the exact information needed, as well as finding other users. Right? And harnessing the power of these users operating as one, right? Being together, not physically, but virtually. Right? So the service starts acting in a completely different role from what one would expect, particularly from the perspective of the legacy paradigm. So what happens here is a very interesting phenomenon from the perspective of the dynamics of participation, because as we establish, user participation leads to a content abundance. But when it comes to content abundance, finding the right type of content is where the value is, right? So while storage costs are very low, the curation costs becomes really valuable. This is the curation costs themselves are high, right? So from the perspective of a company such as Google, what this means is that the storage cost is basically zero, as far as, even though it's not, obviously they have gigantic server farms that they have to constantly maintain, but the real value here is in the algorithm which allows Google, or in companies such as Google, like Facebook, Amazon, Apple, etc., to curate the right sort of content at the right time for the right user and for the right audience, right? So while information wants to be free, it also wants to be expensive. And what emerges here is, again, as mapped by Tim O'Reilly, that the value of the platform, of the software, is a function of the scale and dynamism of the data it helps to manage, right? So the more information is added, the more content is added, the more content abundance, literally, the more valuable the platform becomes, right? So simultaneously, the higher the cost the platform has in terms of curating the data. So the more premium is put on finding the right information for the right person or audience at the right time. So again, user participation leading to content abundance, but content abundance involves, when viewed at scale, at the macro level, high curation costs, which stands for finding the right information at the right time, right? Or in terms of how we described the new economy earlier, actionable knowledge, right? So this is where the value is. And finding that actionable knowledge, that specific needed information, automatically leads to further content abundance, right? So again, it's another dynamic of participation. And the more people use a specific service such as Google, YouTube, etc., the more this dynamic is in play. So the more the service learns, as it were, about the usage patterns of its users, and the better it becomes, the better its algorithm becomes in fostering further participation and further content abundance, right? So we have this dynamic, high curation costs, fostering further content abundance and further participation, because the participation so far has added that extra value, right? By the service being able to extract the patterns, the behavioral patterns that its users demonstrated. So in effect, value here, when it comes to the participation dynamic, value appears as an emergent aggregate of participation. So the more participation, the more value emerges out of the participation, not directly, but indirectly, because of the participatory patterns that start emerging. And they always start emerging in aggregate, right? So you would need the more people one could observe, the more valuable and more detailed these patterns are. Hence the value of companies such as Facebook and Amazon and Google, etc. And the aggregate of participating individual users builds that value as a side effect of their activities, right? So their activities might be completely unrelated to this specific value, but what matters here is the pattern of activities being observed, because that pattern automatically is fed into the system algorithm which allows content curation in the future. And here are the content participation dynamics we've isolated, and they're really important because armed with understanding of these dynamics, we can now move to analyzing the long tail and power law distribution. So we have mass participation, we have the follow-up emergence of content abundance because everyone participates and generates content. This in turn leads to mass amateurization because everyone can participate in whatever regard in any sort of niche area and generate content. So this automatically leads to different aesthetic emerging, different tastes, etc., the lessening of the role of the expert, of the authority figure. We have also very strong pressure on downward pressure on storage costs, so we have lowering of storage costs to an effective zero, which in turn switches value not from from the act of storing and distributing content to the ability to find the right content and at the right time. So the value switches to content curation. And this in turn closes a feedback loop because participation, the mass participation, ends up generating automatic value because it feeds that content curation mechanism. All right, so understanding all of this, we can now approach the notion of the long tail. So this is a phenomenon which can also be described, and I will touch on this down the track in this lecture, as a Pareto distribution or as a power law distribution. All right, so to begin with, we need to take a step back and again look at the previous paradigm, which is what we describe as the legacy media paradigm, the pre-internet paradigm, if you will. So as we already mentioned, this is a paradigm characterized by high production costs and high risk of failure, and the packaging of information as a commodity to be consumed by the audience. The audience does not in any way participate in the production process itself, right? It's closed off. The audience receives a finished product. And this high cost of production and the high risk of failure associated with it act as filters for participation. This is really important to understand, because the end result of this entire process is that we have limits of scale, which are they are non-negotiable, because given that model, one cannot scale up freely, right? The larger the business grows, the higher its transaction costs in that model. We have limits of scale, we have very high costs of entry, and there's a limit also in terms of risk, because there's high risk of failure. And this imposes a model of content creation, which can be described as a hit-driven business model, right? So it's reliant on content packaged as product, which has to be a hit, right? So this has to be a blockbuster. And this hit-driven business model fundamentally is always about the lowest common denominator, right? The lowest common denominator always wins. So think in these terms, if you have a group, if you have a target audience of, let's say, a few million people, you need to find content or a story or a narrative that has to appeal to the vast majority of them, or to as many of them as possible, in order for your content packaged as product to be able to sell to them, right? So this is the basic logic of that hit-driven business model. And the result here is that all the value in this model, right, is packaged, is concentrated in these few blockbusters which dominate sales in each category. So think in terms of the categories of action, or science fiction, or fantasy, or comedy, or whatever. In an environment characterized by a legacy media paradigm, by this hit-driven model we just described, you are automatically dealing with content scarcity. There is only so many pieces of content that the industry can generate, right? And therefore, in this kind of content scarcity environment, those few pieces of content that can appeal to the lowest common denominator, to as many people as possible, invariably dominate sales in each category. And the result here is that all other pieces of content either are not made at all, or are made in such a way so as to maybe recoup losses at best, right? And they never see the light of day beyond a very short, very small period of time. The result here is that lowest common denominator pieces of content, the blockbusters, right, in the context of the film industry, always win in this environment. and niche pieces of content, such as, for example, cult movies or films aimed at niche small audiences, invariably lose, right? Because they simply cannot compete on the terms of the hit-driven business model. This is, again, a content scarcity environment. The mass market in this environment, so whatever is aimed at the lowest common denominator, always beats the niche market. So in other terms, maybe you're interested in specific type of science fiction films, maybe dystopian science fiction films of specific aesthetic, involving specific type of archetypes, etc., etc. The problem is that you will not. This is such a niche area, it has such a niche audience that you will either not get any content in these terms, or it will be content that barely satisfies these requirements. Why? Because in a content scarcity environment, mass market always beats a niche market. And as Chris Anderson describes it in his famous piece, The Long Tail, in Wired from 2004. The tyranny of physical space, right? This is what we're describing here, the hit-driven model. In the tyranny of physical space, an audience too thinly spread is the same as no audience at all, right? So if you're if you're in the business of book sales, or if you're in the business of movie sales or whatever, in that model, you are automatically subject to the tyranny of physical space, because you can put only so many people in a cinema, you can put only so many people in a bookstore, right? And the bookstore can store only so many books. Your entire production and distribution chain is subject to the tyranny of physical space. And on the other end of this transaction, you have an audience which is... especially if you're producing niche content, you have an audience which is so thinly spread naturally that it, for intents and purposes, does not exist, right? So you have to, because of that logic of the tyranny of the physical space, you have to appeal to the lowest common denominator and ignore those niches. And this is an environment where there's literally not enough room to store and distribute content aimed for all possible niche markets, for all possible niche tastes. And the result is that you have a very small number of content pieces, this can be books and movies, etc., which are aimed at the lowest common denominator audience. So far, so good. However, with the arrival of the internet and the emergence of the new economy, which we have been mapping, we have the emergence of this content participation dynamics, which we already talked about. And one of the key elements here is low storage costs trending to zero. And this part of this series of feedback loops, which we already discussed, This one specific element is in and of itself enough to spell the doom of the hit-driven economic model, right? Low storage costs in and of themselves, together with the related content abundance, right, spell the end of the hit-driven economic model. So what we'll do now is I'll show you a brief case study describing how these two models actually clash, because we had the privilege of observing this clash in practice and the results. And the case studies is of the largest bookstore chain in the world in the late 2000s and up until the end of 2010, and which was the Borders bookstore chain and Amazon. And this was a direct clash, because both of these businesses, both of these corporations were competing when it comes to book sales, right? So this was, apart from everything else Amazon is doing, Amazon of course started as a a bookselling website, and Amazon clashed directly. There was a frontal clash with the Borders bookstore empire, and Borders bookstores looked more or less like this. So these were huge bookstores. They were described as superstores, so they would sell books, they would sell music, they would sell all sorts of you know, stationery and things like that, and they were globally spread. They had at the end of 2010 around 511 superstores in the United States alone. And so this was a massive global operation, a gigantic company with 511 superstores only in the United States. And this company clashed head on with Amazon, with Amazon's business model. And the business model of Borders was obviously based on what we already described as the hit-driven model. And it clashed with that content abundance model as demonstrated by Amazon. And quickly reveal, the end of this clash was that Borders collapsed and it filed for bankruptcy in 2011. And the reason for this is very simple. I just now showed you how the Borders bookstore looked like, and you can compare that with any other bookstore, they look the same. But this is how a typical Amazon warehouse looks like. And as you can see, its mode of organization is vastly different. Amazon has hundreds of those warehouses and distribution centers spread around the globe. And for our intents and purposes, what you're seeing on the screen now is how infinite shelf space looks like. The shelf space that Borders has is more or less the top 20 or so percent of book sales that of books that could be popular enough to appeal to the lowest common denominator, right? So you're having you're thinking here of you know, the most popular authors overall. So each Borders bookstore would be stocking those. You're thinking of the most popular genres, you know, for example, you would have romance and fantasy and science fiction and crime, thriller and drama, etc. And you would have, when it comes to those genres, you would have the top positions, the top books for each genre being present. So overall, you would have more or less the top 20% of sales when it comes to the top 20% of books when it comes to sales. And this is basically how the tyranny of physical space looks like. So each Borders bookstore, is superstore for that matter, would have around 150,000 books overall, plus or minus a few thousand. And this sounds like a lot, right? When you think about 150,000 books, who would need more choice than that? But this is basically the tip of the iceberg when it comes to the all possible books that people could be interested in, right? Think in terms of niche interest. Think in terms of books that are out of print now. Think in terms of self-published books. Think in terms of rare books on topics that, you know, a few thousand people in the world might be interested in. What about those books? Where are they in Borders? And of course, they're absent. Why? Because of the tyranny of physical space, which in turn determines the hit-driven business model. And you can contrast this with the Amazon shelf space, which I described earlier as an infinite shelf space. Why? Because Amazon has no costs when it comes to storing all possible books ever printed or ever created, not even printed yet, that they might print in order to make one sale, right? So this is what the long tail actually is in practice. The long tail is not only that top 20% when it comes to a specific type of content or when it comes to a specific, let's say, genre of novels, but also to the long tail of everything else which is part of this genre, but it's not in the top 20% in terms of current popularity, right? So think in terms of fantasy, and you know, obviously the top 20 would include J.K. Rowling and J.R.R. Martin and maybe J.R.R. Tolkien and a few other authors, and that would be that. That would be it. But there is a long tail of hundreds upon hundreds of thousands of other authors who have sometime in the past published something which could be qualified as fantasy. Where are those books? And they're available on Amazon, right? And Amazon tries to continuously improve its offering when it comes to all possible imaginable genres and niches. Why? Because it is not subject to the tyranny of physical space. It is leveraging the long tail. And this was described excellently by Chris Anderson, where he frames it as: the market for books that are not even sold in the average bookstore is larger than the market for those that are. Because when you're thinking in terms of access to a very limited selection of possible choices, right? When you're operating in an environment of content scarcity, then the hit-driven model will be the dominant model. It will inform the logic of your choices. But when you're operating in an environment of content abundance, everything changes. And suddenly that long tail of possible choices, right, which go to practically to infinity, right, automatically dwarfs, and by dwarfs I mean really dwarfs, the sales of the largest hits. Right? Because the largest hits would still be very popular with a large number of people, but a vastly larger number of sales would be made on the long tail, among the books that are not even sold in the average bookstore, among the books that have an audience in the hundreds or thousands in the world, as opposed to the books that have audience in the millions in the world. And this marks a transition from a hit-driven model to an aggregate of niches. And this is what websites such as Amazon are, they're aggregates of niches. This is exactly what Netflix is doing as well, or that what Spotify is doing as well. They allow you to aggregate all sorts of niche tastes to form your own specific niche collections of content. This is the value that they're providing. And in the words of Chris Anderson, it doesn't matter if the several thousand people who rent Doctor Who episodes each month are in one city or spread one per town across the country, or the world for that matter. The economics are the same to Netflix. It has, in short, broken the tyranny of physical space. What matters is not where customers are, or even how many of them are seeking a particular title, but only that some number of them exist anywhere. Right? Why is that? This low cost of storage, low tending to zero, right? So from the perspective of the big aggregators such as Netflix or Amazon, the cost of storing a title is basically zero. From their perspective, it's free. And if that title can generate a few sales globally, it has already paid off its cost tending to zero. And this completely puts on its head what was until recently the common sense when it comes to the business model for production, distribution, and storage of content. Because now, for the first time, you may be a niche market of one in your location. So you might have interests which do not overlap or do not are not shared by anyone in your physical location, in your neighborhood or your town even. Right? You might be interested in falconry and no one in your town is sharing that interest. But online, you will be able to find a very large community of people who are interested in falconry as well. Right? From the perspective of companies such as Amazon and Netflix or Spotify or all the other aggregators out there, this is the logic that defines their decisions. Right? Is there a group of people online that share this interest. Because if there is such a group, then it is automatically forming a niche that that is tremendously valuable to these aggregators, because they can start aggregating content for that specific niche. So remember what we established earlier, there is a fundamental value here that is being produced by users participating in the platform. That's a side effect of their participation, right? These patterns are extracted by the system. So when it comes to users of Amazon, for example, the patterns of choices, of preferences demonstrated by users automatically inform the Amazon recommendation algorithm, right? Same thing applies to Netflix and Spotify or all other aggregators for that matter. So in this context, the future of entertainment is in the millions of niche markets at the shallow end of the bitstream. And the shallow end of the bitstream, as Chris Anderson describes it, is the long tail, right? So this is what the shallow end stands for. So what we have in effect is low storage costs leading to practically infinite shelf space. And compulsive and constant participation coming from users in turn generates real-time information about buying trends, right? So this is where the algorithm comes in. And the two combined together create an environment where you have insatiable demand for niche content, right? So niche content is all that matters. You, of course, would have the big hits still operating, but value will be spread across the entire length of the long tail. And this looks in practice, these are illustrations from the original Chris Anderson article in Wired in 2004. It looks in practice in this way. So you would have the songs that are available here on, in this case, the service is Rhapsody, but you can substitute this for Spotify or Netflix or Amazon. The content that is available on these platforms, on the long tail, would dwarf in terms of sales the content that is available everywhere else in terms of the top 20, and that is the most popular at some particular point of time. And this in terms of feeds this recommendation algorithm, which automatically leads to further and deeper niches emerging, right? Why? Because the logic here is of information sorting, and it leads automatically, right, through user participation to further refinement of the recommendation algorithm and to more specific, more precise, more niche pieces of content made to appeal to that specific user group. Of course, the end point here is content which is specifically recommended for an individual person on this planet, right? So the end point of this process is algorithms which are so refined in terms of the patterns that have been observed and in terms of their curation recommendation power that they can successfully and continuously recommend content unique to each individual person on the planet. And this leads us to the phenomenon of the long tail itself. And this is a fascinating phenomenon. It was first observed by an Italian economist called Wilfred Pareto in the 19th century in Italy when, and that's why it's called the Pareto distribution as well, when he was looking at land ownership patterns in Italy, and he observed that around 20% of owners, landowners, own around 80% of land. So initially he thought he has made a mistake, so he looked again and again, first in different areas of Italy, then in the entire country. Then he started looking at other countries, and he observed invariably the same proportions. Around 20% of owners owning around 80% of land. And so he described this discovery, which was later generalized as a power law distribution. And a power law distribution is an emergent phenomenon in when it comes to large numbers, to when it comes to large groupings of data. And they can be observed, they are basically axiomatic. They always emerge when you have large groupings of data or large gatherings of people with random characteristics, right? So if you have a very large group of people gathered together, let's say on accident, you would and you look at everyone's wallet, invariably 20% of the people in that random group of 1,000 people would have around 80% of the money in everyone's wallet, right? So this is a emergent phenomenon, right? It's mathematical in its nature, and it's axiomatic. It always emerges, right? So this is not something subject to subjective interpretation. And colloquially, it is known as the long tail because of that specific distribution. And for our intents and purposes, power law distributions and all the long tail are fascinating because they denote a very interesting side effect of an environment of content abundance. And the side effect is that the very act of choosing, and this is what we do as participants, right? So we talked about participation, the very act of choosing content, acting as participants in that environment, spread widely enough and freely enough, right? So viewed in at a macro level in aggregate over time, automatically, invariably creates a power law distribution. Right, so this is again non-negotiable. If you have a huge amount of content and a random group of people looking at that content, invariably the majority of people, let's say 80% of the people, would be focusing on 20% of the content. Right, so you would have these proportions emerging, or variation of them thereof. And you can observe this, for example, when it comes to the distribution of Wikipedia editors. So on this graph, you have on the left side, you have the people who are acting in 2010 as page patrollers. So these are the people who are patrolling different pages on Wikipedia and editing them and making sure that the edits are correct, etc. So on the left, you have the number of page patrollers, and below, you have the number of pages patrolled by each individual editor, right? So on the left, you have page patrollers, below the pages patrolled. And you can see that you have a clear power law distribution emerging. Again, this is simply a function of the large number of people being involved. So you have a tiny minority, tiny sliver of people who end up patrolling and editing tens of thousands of pages, and you have a very long tail of people who end up patrolling, let's say, one or two or five pages only, right? So you have a clear power law distribution. And then an important point here of clarification, the larger the sample size, the more people or the more pieces of content, whatever one is observing, the more pronounced the power law distribution is going to be. So given a completely random group of people, if you give them complete freedom to choose between a range of diverse content options, they will inevitably create a power law distribution, right? So this has profound effects when it comes to an environment of content abundance, as we will discover in a moment. Because what happens is, as encapsulated brilliantly by Clay Shirky, that when you have a massive diversity of content, and when you have freedom of choice, right? So the users are given complete freedom in choosing what content they want. Invariably, this generates massive inequality, massive power law distributions. A few pieces of content end up being popular with the vast majority of the users who had the freedom of choice, right? And crucially, and this is really very important, the greater the diversity, so the more variety in terms of content choices, the more extreme the inequality is going to be, right? So again, the greater the diversity, the more extreme the inequality. In other words, an abundance of information, an abundance of content, leads to a situation where you can dedicate your attention only to a very limited amount of of content, a set amount of content. And the more information is there, right, the more variety, the more diversity when it comes to information, the more pronounced those limitations are going to be, because you are still locked into a specific amount of possible content to engage with by the limitations of your attention. And hence, an abundance of information leading to the scarcity of attention. Which leads us to the final and most important part of this lecture, which builds on everything we've discussed so far, this notion of the attention economy. And the first thing you need to understand about the attention economy is that this is an economy which is an emergent quality, if you will, of content abundance. So this is an economy which emerges from the fact that we are drowning in possible content choices. We are drowning in information, right? So this is, again, entirely a function of the information society paradigm, right? And the way Kevin Kelly describes it in Better Than Free from 2008 is really interesting, because he talks about the internet as a copy machine. At its most foundational level, it copies every action, every character, every thought we make while we ride upon it. In order to send a message from one corner of the internet to another, the protocols of communication demand that the whole message be copied along the way several times. The digital economy is thus run on a river of copies. So this is what content abundance actually is here, right? It's this river of copies. Unlike the mass-produced reproductions of the machine age, these copies are not just cheap, they are free, right? And they are free in all senses of the word. And Michael Goldhaber, the person who actually coined the term the attention economy in 1997 in a famous piece in again, Wired magazine, describes it as follows. By definition, economics is the study of how society uses its scarce resources. And information is not scarce, especially on the internet, where it is not only abundant, but overflowing. Again, content abundance. We are drowning in information, yet constantly increasing our generation of it. Again, here, the notion of participation. So a key question arises. Is there something else that flows through cyberspace, something that is scarce and desirable? There is. No one would put anything on the internet without the hope of obtaining some. It is called attention. And the economy of attention, not information, is the natural economy of cyberspace. Right? So these are prophetic words, right? Michael Goldhaber coins this term in the late 90s, where none of the big aggregator websites are still yet operating. Like Google has not even been founded yet. Neither has been Facebook or Amazon, for that matter, right? And here we have this idea of the economy of attention, the natural economy of cyberspace. As Lexi Kane argues, we are presented with a wealth of information, but we have the same amount of mental processing power as we have always had. The number of minutes has also stayed exactly the same in every day. Today, attention, not information, is the limiting factor. So you have to think in terms of the bottleneck. That's where the scarcity is, obviously. And the scarcity has stopped residing with information, right? The scarcity resided with information and with content in the legacy media paradigm, in the hit-driven model, in the industrial society, right? It stopped residing there with the appearance of the internet. And therefore, it's not information that is scarce and valuable anymore as such. It is attention that becomes scarce and valuable. It's attention that is the limiting factor. And we already described this dynamic. The more information is there, the more content abundance, the more information abundance, the more scarce attention becomes, and the more valuable it becomes automatically. And armed with this understanding, we can now make two key observations. The first one is that information abundance has a power-law distribution, right? So the more information there is, the more pronounced that power law distribution is going to be, the more the long tail effect will be in play, right? And in an environment of total information abundance, it will be extremely pronounced. And simultaneously, the second observation is that attention scarcity leads to parallel distributions emerging in each content niche. Because of that total information / content abundance, attention scarcity becomes so important, so valuable, that it ends up generating parallel distributions in each possible imaginable niche, because each possible imaginable niche ends up being saturated with content and information. And Michael Goldhaber also described another aspect of the attention economy that is really fascinating, and that is that in and of itself, its dynamics lead to a realization that it's a zero-sum game, right? So what a zero-sum game means, this is observation coming from game theory, that and it stands for the fact that if someone loses, someone else has to win. If someone gets something, someone else has to be denied that something, right? And this is interesting because when it comes to internet information itself, there is no zero-sum game, because the internet is a river of copies. There is no scarcity associated with information. But when it comes to attention, you have massive parallel distributions and fundamentally a zero-sum game appearing, right? Because someone would get the attention, but someone else would not. So again, attention scarcity leads to parallel distributions across the board. And information abundance in and of itself generates parallel distributions. So what are the implications here when it comes to attention long tails, when it comes to attention power law distributions? Well, first and foremost, this is the emergence of the social network phenomenon. And as Mark Manson describes this, social networks are the business model of the attention economy. They are wholly dependent on eyeballs and clicks to make all of their revenue. To do this, they design algorithms that show you the most interesting and attention-grabbing information available in your social network, right? So again, returning to what we described earlier, the value here is when it comes to curation. The value is provided by the ability to curate content specifically for you or specifically for that user group, right? So hence, algorithms that show you the most interesting and attention-grabbing information available in your social network. If your newsfeed was full of the boring and drab day-to-day stuff, you'd stop looking at it. So instead, Facebook shows you the most extreme occurrences in your social network for the simple reason that the extreme events draw the most attention. Again, this is a feedback loop, right? The algorithm keeps refining that feedback loop based on your pattern of behavior. So the more attention you show to specific types of content, and you are likely to be drawn to specific types of content because they're interesting to you, right? There is something that differentiates them from the drab day-to-day stuff, right? Something that makes them non-trivial. They stand out. So you start looking at that stuff that is non-trivial and stands out, and you're starting to exhibit a pattern here. So the algorithm keeps feeding you more and more of that stuff. More and more extreme examples of that stuff. Why? Because it draws clearly your attention, right? So this is an attention-driven model. And what ends up happening is what we describe as polarization. What ends up happening is groups of people in these niche markets, right? Niche communities are being more and more polarized, so going drifting more and more into further niches away from what used to be, let's call it the mainstream, away from what used to be the lowest common denominator, right? They end up being polarized into further extremes. And again, this is an inevitable side effect of the dynamics of power law distributions and attention. Another interesting effect when it comes to attention long tails is this phenomenon that we already encountered. The greater the diversity, the more extreme the inequality. Because what happens is a further development of inequalities, right? So attentional long tails in any area, in even in a completely niche area, invariably produce vast inequalities, right? Because it's attention that is scarce, it's not information. And the more information you feed in that specific niche area, the more pronounced those inequalities are going to be. So think in terms of a platform, let's say Twitch or any other platform. When that platform first started, you would have a very limited choice of content because there's a very limited number of content producers, right? So there is actually a very small variety. And views are shared more or less equally among those content producers because there's a very limited amount of content in the first place. But the more content is being created, the more producers join the platform, automatically, the more inequality between the views. And the more diversity is added, automatically the more inequality is going to appear, right? So again, remember, diversity equals inequality, right? And this is an axiom here. This is a non-negotiable mathematical phenomenon. So what do we have so far? Let's systematize. We have information abundance, content abundance, which automatically, right, the more it grows, the more it displays a power law distribution. Information abundance has a long tail. Concomitantly, as it grows in abundance, content, abundant content, leads to the emergence of the pronounced noticeable emergence of attention scarcity, right? So you can only look at so much at any given time. So everyone ends up looking at a very limited amount of content out of the vast diversity of content available, and invariably a power law distribution emerges. And with the continuous participation of users and refinement of curation algorithms and continuous increase in content abundance, you have long tails emerging in each possible content niche, right? So no matter how narrow and limited that specific niche is, you will have a long tail, you have a parallel distribution emerging invariably. And the more content is added, the more pronounced that distribution is going to be. The more diversity, the more polarization, the more inequality. And the other thing we discovered is that the attention economy is a zero-sum game, right? If someone is being paid attention, someone else invariably is not paid attention by that person who is paying the attention. And again, the end effect here is polarization and inequality because of the pronounced power law distributions. And as Kevin Kelly describes it, the money in this networked economy does not follow the path of the copies, right? Because they are abundant and free. Rather, it follows the path of attention, and attention has its own circuits. So what we're trying to describe here and tangle with is this circuits of attention. Crucially, and this is where we need to go next in order to really understand these circuits of attention. In order to move up on that power law distribution in terms of, let's say, your content producer, and if you want to move up on the power law distribution to be more noticeable for people to pay more attention to you, you need to somehow engage beyond the copy, beyond pure providing simply information, because the copy itself is free for all intents and purposes. It's super abundant. We're talking here about the internet as the river of copy. So you want to move up along the attention long tail, you need to engage beyond the copy. And the way Kevin Kelly describes this phenomenon is through this notion of generative value. And he identifies 8 specific examples of generative value, which are really useful in order to understand how those dynamics of attention can be leveraged beyond the copy. So he talks about immediacy, patronage, personalization, authenticity, accessibility, findability, embodiment, and interpretation. And I'll quickly map all of them in turn. So let's start with immediacy. And immediacy is a very simple concept here. Copy itself, information itself might be free, but allowing users to be first when it comes to accessing that information has value in and of itself, right? So first in line commands an extra price for the same good, because the time quotient here starts playing a role. Next comes patronage. And patronage is really interesting here because it adds a level of engagement which goes beyond the simple attention, beyond the simple act of paying attention to a piece of content. That's this emotional connection. And this can be easily observed with websites such as Patreon, where you have a personalized and customizable interactions with content producers, and they invariably generate an emotional connection which builds above and beyond the logic of the copy when it comes to attention. So we have immediacy and patronage. We also have personalization, and personalization is interesting because while the copy can be copied at infinitum, right? So each and every individual piece of content in and of itself is free. There's no value in it because it can be infinitely replicated. The value proposition comes from the stuff that cannot be copied. In this sense, think of customization. Generating a personal relationship when it comes to that specific piece of content for that specific user or for that specific narrow niche audience. You cannot copy the customized personal aspect of a relationship. So again, this goes beyond the simple act of paying attention. Then we have authenticity. And authenticity, again, is a variation of personalization. The adding something which goes beyond the copy. In this sense, in this case, this is a specific, an example of, let's say, a creator signing a book or signing some sort of object that goes together with the digital copy, which provides that extra value. Then we have accessibility, allowing access to content wherever users want it, whenever they want it, and in any place, right? So think of accessibility as a business model, and try and think of the vast number of platforms which are operating entirely around this as the added value, not the content itself, but making it accessible to you whenever you want. And then we have findability. And findability is directly related to this notion of curation, right? So you can think of Google's primary business model as being organized around findability, right? Because a piece of content is fundamentally valuable if it can be paid attention to within the vast ocean of other pieces of content. So no matter what its price, a work has no value unless it generates attention. Hence the valorization of findability, of allowing someone, helping someone to find something. Again, content abundance and the scarcity of attention. Then we have embodiment. In this classic example here is the DJ, right? The music creator who posts their work for free on YouTube or on SoundCloud, but and are leveraging this to increase their potential audience, but actually earning value through the physical performance, right? Because it generates value through embodiment, something that cannot be copied, right? So the physical performance actually might be live streamed for free on YouTube, but being there in that small group of people that managed to be there physically has a value in and of itself, hence the value of embodiment. And finally, interpretation. And again, the classic dictum here is software is free, the manual is expensive. So interpretation is a fascinating concept because this is also the provision of information, but it's a very specific information. This is information unpacking or contextualizing or providing additional details to an existing piece of content. So let's say You can think of interpretation in terms of gaming, or interpretation in terms of book reviews, or in terms of film reviews, etc., etc. Right. So the potentialities here are infinite. There are as many as the amount of content out there. The key is that this is the provision of extra value on top of the piece of content that is in and of itself free. So again, generative value is a key proposition when it comes to content abundance. All right, so let's systematize what we discovered in this lecture. We have specific content participation dynamics emerging, starting with mass participation on a distributed information network, the internet, which leads to the abundance of content, the abundance of information, which in turn leads to the phenomenon of mass amateurization, everyone participating in all sorts of different forms, which turns in turn puts downward pressure on storage costs and leads to low to or next to zero costs of the storage of information itself. So this is pure logistics, which in turn leads to the emergence of and the transition of value away from the act of storing and broadcasting information to the act of finding information in the ocean of other information, right? So the value transitions to content curation. And finally, the appearance of this strange side effect of participation, which is value generation through a pattern detection, right? So the algorithm is fed the patterns of our choices and keeps improving its curation of content, right? Which puts further download pressure on storage costs, etc., etc. So this is a closed feedback loop between these phenomena. And we also mapped the interesting phenomenon when it comes to the attention economy and the long tail effect. So we have this notion of information abundance automatically leading to a massive power law distribution, and the more pronounced the more profound the content abundance, right, the more growth in terms of additional information, the more pronounced the long tail. And invariably, information abundance leads to further scarcity of attention. We can only dedicate so much of our attention to a limited number of content, and then automatically attention scarcity leads to further long tails emerging in each content niche. We have the attention economy emerging from all of this, acting as a zero-sum game. Some pieces of content are being paid attention, some pieces of content are ignored necessarily because of that, and this leads to polarization in inequality. The more diversity, the more content is being added, the more the further polarization grows, and the more inequality is there, the more pronounced these power law distributions, these long tails are in effect. And the way to establish long tail differentiation is through generative value. All right, this is it for this lecture from me. If you have any questions, please contact me on Twitter at TedMeetYou. Thank you all for listening, and see you online.